Good morning, everyone. I want to welcome everybody to another town hall that we've had, and we're looking forward to be able to have the chance to speak with everybody this morning. I'm joined this morning with our chief human resource officer, that would be Steve Jones, our CFO and vice president of admin and finance, Ben Lowenthal, vice president for student affairs, Dr. Vernon Hurt, and the provost and executive vice president of academic affairs, Melanie Perot. We're about halfway, a little more than halfway through the semester, and we've made some significant decisions and announcements with regard to the spring semester. So I thought it would be a very good time for us to have a check-in. With that, I think it's best that we just open it up for questions and proceed from there.
Thank you, President Schatzel. Good morning, everybody. I am Sean Welsh. I'm the interim vice president for University Marketing and Communications, and I'll serve as the moderator for this morning's faculty and staff town hall. A recording of this town hall will be made available on the university website this week. For those of you who have not entered questions before in one of our town halls, please use the Q&A function on your Zoom screen to submit your questions for our panelists. We've already had a quick round the Zoom introduction of everybody, so I feel like we can go ahead and get started. So to get things going here, we'll start off to the provost. If you could please just give us a brief rundown of our plans for the spring term.
Great, thanks, Sean. So the plan was announced last week. It's sort of the high level plan. And so I'm just gonna hit some of the highlights if people haven't seen those announcements. So we have determined we will follow the already previously scheduled academic calendar. So we'll start on time, we will end on time, and we will have a spring break as scheduled in there. The plan for delivery of academic classes is to have it the same as we planned for the fall. So that is faculty will once again be able to determine their modality, whether it's remote or some version of a hybrid delivery of the course. Our expectation is that around 85% of the courses will be delivered in a remote fashion. And I once again just want to thank everybody for working so hard to very quickly learn how to do that for those who hadn't ever delivered a course remotely. And in particular, everybody who moved very quickly to adopt it a synchronous modality when it became very clear that that's what the students were requesting. So I really just appreciate that. And so that is our expectation for the spring. Again, we expect the vast majority of courses will be delivered remotely, but that there will be some hybrid activity on campus at greatly reduced density. So one of the changes that we have made is that the first 2 weeks of the semester, when everybody returns or when we start up, will be delivered in the same fashion as the same position that we are right now, which is that everything will be remote with the special carve outs that we've made for clinical education, maybe an internship that cannot be performed remotely, in the rare case where there's a laboratory that must be done face to face. The first 2 weeks of the semester, we really want to have as much of it delivered remotely as possible. If the circumstances that health and safety indicates that this is okay, after that first 2 week period, what we'd like to do is open up courses in the way that we intended to for this fall semester. So that is opening up those classrooms at those greatly reduced densities, having some opportunity for more face-to-face education, again, at faculty choice, but also at student choice, where we would simultaneously deliver using the technology that we invested in, so that if a student feels uncomfortable coming to a face-to-face course, they have that option as well. So both faculty and students will have that the chance to choose that. We do expect that there will be students in our residence halls. So the plan for the residence halls is again greatly reduced. This is slightly changed from what we intended in the fall. What the plan will be that roughly 2,300 students will be in our residence halls. Every student will have a single, so that's really important. That's the change. We had originally planned that in small numbers there might be some doubles, But given what the science and what the CDC has said, we have shifted there. And so any student in our residence halls will be in a single. And another change that we've made is that we've doubled the amount of quarantine and isolation space for students who live on our campus. So we've really increased that. Our testing center will continue to operate. Right now, the plan is that upon return, all people who intend to be on the campus, students, staff, faculty, will be required to have a test upon their return. And then we will shift into the sentinel testing practice as we have right now. Again, this is all dependent on what the best medical and scientific advice is at the time. And as we've seen, this has sort of shifted over time. And as the medical and scientific advice has shifted, so too have we. And so we've always said that will be our priority. We'll follow the science. Health and safety is our number one priority. And I think we've demonstrated that commitment this semester. And we fully expect, of course, to be able to do that again in the spring. So that is the general outline of what we anticipate for our spring semester. And I think there'll probably be many follow-up questions to that, but I just want to turn it over then to that.
That's great. Thank you very much for that outline. And then the follow-up to that, President Schatzel, would be, what have we learned from our experience this fall that makes us feel confident in this plan for the spring?
Thank you, Sean. I think that everybody reflects, if we're going to take a chance to be reflective, we can say the fact that, you know, we did have a surge. It was very, very early in the semester. And if we take a look at what we've learned since then by looking at other institutions, remember, we had many institutions that opened in hybrid, but many that decided to go completely online, such as Hopkins and Loyola and Morgan State. From that time, what we've seen is several things. One is the fact that continuing with a hybrid and vast majority of the classes being online is really the preferred method of delivery to be able to ensure continuity of the classrooms. But we are going to have hybrid, and we are going to be able to have some face-to-face, as the provost described, for laboratories, internships, and performing arts, et cetera, that really emphasize that mode of delivery. We've also taken a look at the residence halls in a very similar way, in the fact to be able to de-densify and to be able to provide for the fact that we want to be able to have just singles for the students and be able to have that the mode that we're having in the residence halls. We're doubling the size of our isolation and quarantine space, and we will have other units available should we need to be able to expand. And that's very critical, is to make sure that we have the level of inventory to be able to respond to the fact of having incidents of virus on the campus. And I think that's something that we need to be able to understand. The virus, it will be on the campus. We're going to do everything we can to be able to identify it and be able to identify those that might have been exposed and ask them to be able to quarantine, and those that are diagnosed to be able to self-isolate. And we've really built up the infrastructure around that support to be able to do it. We have a medical advisory group that contains, that has on it individuals from Baltimore County Health, medical practitioners from GBMC, from our own health center, the dean of our own College of Health Professions, as well as the chair of nursing. So we have medical professionals that are on call and that are meeting weekly to be able to advise us for that as well. But we're also looking at the fact that there's been a change in terms of the state. As you can see, the fact that restaurants are opening at limited capacities, there's announcements of the fact that gatherings can be larger. And this is all being guided by the state and local directives, and we'll follow those. But my expectation is the fact that we will have a semester that's changed to be able to adjust to the requirements and the safety precautions and public health precautions that are in place, but that we will have a vibrant, given those circumstances, campus in the spring. We will always be able to pivot if we need to be able to do that. But I'm very, very pleased with the work that's been done to be able to prepare the campus. A key issue, as the provost said, is that we will go online for the first 2 weeks as well. And the results of the sentinel testing for the last almost month now We've tested hundreds of students, faculty, and staff and during that time period, and we've had zero cases from the testing itself. So we're going to keep track of all of these indicators and work closely as a campus community, as well as work closely with Baltimore County Public Health. And again, I'm just very, very pleased at all the preparation that's been done and all the planning that's been done for the spring.
Thank you. I think Provost Perot alluded to this in her initial response, but one of the first questions we had in is in regards to testing for the spring. Will a baseline test be required to return to for individuals to return to campus for the spring term? I'll hand that over to AVP Jones to answer.
As the provost indicated, there will be baseline testing prior to return for the spring semester. We'll be issuing the logistics and the details of that in the coming months, but we're going to have a window of 14 days prior to the return to get that negative test on file. So the details of that will be coming, but we will in fact require baseline testing prior to the return to campus in January.
Thank you. We have another question in regards to health and safety of the campus. And this one I'll pass to Vice President Lowenthal. Will sanitation stations remain in place for the spring term? Those are the hand sanitizer and so forth that we have throughout the campus. Will those return in the spring?
Yes, all of those hand sanitation stations will remain. They're still here now and they will remain in the way to replenish if someone notices that they need replenishment remains the same too. There's signage on each one of those stations just to give a call into work control or to do an email, and we'll ensure that all of those remain well stocked.
Thank you. Question in for Vice President Hurt. This one is in regards to student life in the spring term. Can you talk a little bit more about what things will be available for students on campus, whether Burdick will be open, whether some of the traditional things that students might expect to experience on campus in the spring might happen. And then on top of that, what you anticipate the first 2 weeks while classes remain in a remote modality might look like in terms of on-campus activities.
Sure, thanks for the question, Sean. As President Schatzel mentioned earlier, we wanna have a solid level of vibrancy on campus, and that includes really enhancing and increasing our campus life. We've had an opportunity to take a look at what is happening at other institutions. We have put plans in place, both looking at room density, but outdoor spacing and opportunities to be able to provide that. So our team of student activities is working even now to begin to prepare. We anticipate just having more, again, both virtual, but enhancing our face-to-face opportunities for engagement. Burdick Hall will be open. Burdick is actually was one of the facilities that we've kept open this fall. It has been a great opportunity really to test out some of our protocols. We've had a really strong number of usage each week, hundreds of users each week. The protocols are in line with national best practices, and we've just had really great operations. So we're looking forward to continuing that because we know that as we center again health and safety needs, not just in our preparation, but also in our offerings. So we want to ensure that we continue to offer ways that our campus can stay engaged and continuing to promote a healthy lifestyle and in a safe way. So, you know, look forward to having more opportunities available. We're even thinking about piloting some activities the latter part of this semester. And certainly in those first 2 weeks, we wanna be able to engage and really help students build that sense of community and sense of connection back to campus. We know, particularly for our first year students and for our seniors, this has been an impactful year. And so we really want to, again, bring that vibrancy back to campus, but centering our health and safety priorities as we do it.
Thank you. Question in a little bit about the schedule for the spring, and I'll pass this to Provost Perot. What are our plans around spring break? Are we keeping spring break intact, or are there changes around spring break for the spring term?
Thank you. There's been a lot of discussion around spring break, and I'm sure you've seen that nationally. This is a question that some universities are keeping and some are canceling. And we had an awful lot of discussion with our medical advisors, with students, with faculty. You know, we really dug into this question because it is a difficult one. However, where we landed is to have the spring break, and that's for a number of reasons. One of the things that became pretty clear to us after consulting with all sorts of folks is that people need a break. I've seen a lot of questions scroll by about sort of rising mental health issues and anxieties and concerns, and building in that break, we think will just give that opportunity for everybody to sort of step back and have a little, just a break for some of the very real Zoom fatigue that we've all been feeling, students, staff, faculty, all of us. And so that weighed significantly into that decision to keep spring break. And you'll see, I think when you see other institutions make their announcements, that this is a common theme that's been going around. But it also has to do with the fact that we're confident in our health and safety protocols, and that we are, our testing center has really been working hard, and we have great accuracy. We have a quick results. We're confident in our quarantine space. So should we, there be an outbreak, we're also confident in our students that we will set some standards and some expectations for our students and about health and safety and keeping others safe. And so all of these weighed together. And so when we put it all together, the answer became clear that we can have a spring break, we should have a spring break, and that once again, we'll put health and safety around it so that it's people can feel confident about that decision.
Thank you. We have a couple questions coming in regards to staffing and our measures as a university to kind of combat any budget issues as it pertains to staffing. I'll pass this one to President Schatzel to begin with on an answer. I'm sure there's some others that might have some thoughts as well. Is TU still in a position to avoid layoffs and avoid furloughs at this point in time?
Thanks, Sean. I can tell you the answer is that we are. We're in a position, and we continue to have the commitment that we will only consider layoffs or furloughs as an absolute last resort. We lost about $40 million worth of revenue in fiscal 20, and we're looking at about $75 million in fiscal 21. But we've done a tremendous amount of countermeasures to be able to offset that. We had CARES stimulus funds that came through. We also did operating budget cuts that everybody participated in. We did a hiring freeze right out of the chute in March to be able to make sure of two things. One is that we didn't hire people during a pandemic that would make it difficult for them to be able to orient themselves and acclimate to our community. We didn't think that was putting too much pressure on people to be able to do that. And also concerns of the fact, given that there was so much uncertainty with budget, that if we did have to move the layoffs or furloughs, those newly hired people would be the first to go. And that was not something that we wanted to do to people. We also stopped all capital except those associated with our major projects that were required from health and safety, stopped all business travel, and just across the board looked at every opportunity to be able to reduce our cost structure, including utilities costs. So there's a long list of things that were done. And we're in a good position fiscally to be able to maintain that commitment. We received about $13 million of cuts from the state that we're still considering. It's part of the budget that we're looking at. We don't know what next year's going to look like yet. The governor's budget will be revealed to us at anywhere from December 26th through the second week of January. Many of you have read the fact that the revenue estimates that have come in were far better than anyone ever anticipated. So we're keeping a close eye on that. I've spent the last 2 weeks talking to many of the legislators that are in leadership position, both with the Senate and the House, on the tax and budget committees to be able to get a sense of what they're looking at. And I would say that they're cautiously optimistic as well. And I would say cautiously optimistic in the fact of taking a look at further cuts that would be draconian in any sense. But of course, until we see the estimates in December, we won't have the full picture. But we are feeling, again, cautiously optimistic about capital. So there's a lot of things that are occurring between now and the end of January, beginning of February, that will tell us. But as it is right now, I can assure everyone that, first of all, everything that everybody has done, and I know it has been a burden and on everyone to be able to support the fact that we want to reduce costs, support the fact that we haven't been able to hire, that we've had the hiring freeze on. So people have had to do far more with less and taken on responsibilities that they might not have had before. But the outcome of that is the fact that we can feel confident, the fact that it's working and it's putting us in a position where furloughs or layoffs are something that we feel we will not have to make use of in order to have the our fiscal position remain strong. Ben, would you like to add anything? I think it's good that the CFO weighs in on what I just said as well.
You covered it very well, thank you. I would just add my appreciation and thanks to everyone that's on the call and everyone that's not on the call, because your cooperation and all of the freezes and various cuts that we've put in place really has led directly to our ability to make these statements that there are no furloughs and layoffs at Towson University in the future as we see it, because it's been, the cooperation has been excellent. So I just reiterate my appreciation.
And I just want to add that both the plans for the spring, as well as the conversations around budget, our shared governance bodies, that would be SGA, the Staff Senate, and the Academic Senate, they've been tremendous partners to the administration. We've gotten great feedback, great counsel, great advice. We've modified some of our initial proposals in response to what's been shared with us and the ideas and the concerns they might have brought up. Shared governance is an important part of what we do as a university. We always, I always want to be able to say that as an administrator and as a president that I always listen, because that's the first thing that we want to be able to do when it comes to shared governance and the counsel that they provide. But I can tell you the fact that their counsel and their advice to us has been very, very important in terms of the plans for the spring, and as well as how we've addressed the pandemic and its effect on the institution from a fiscal standpoint. So I just want to make sure that I thank those leaders in those positions, as well as the members of those bodies, for everything they've done to be able to support the university and support the administration in our decisions.
I can add that RPAC and Budget Committee have also been very, very helpful in that same vein. So thank you.
John, just a quick point related to that. The temporary job reassignment program has also been very effective to help us utilize resources across the university. And we've had close to a dozen individuals who have been placed in different places of need across the university, because with the hiring freeze, we still have need to get things done in areas that we're not in a position to hire a full-time employee. And we've had individuals who have had additional capacity that we've been able to move. It's helped them develop, it's helped us get work done. But again, the temporary job reassignment program is another critical part of this.
Thank you all for your answers to that. That was great. Question now about the modality for the spring and how we're kind of communicating that to faculty and students too, for that matter. Will individuals know what the class formats will be in advance of registration for spring classes? And how will we let them know that?
Yeah, so like last time, if you look in the course notes. So each course has a course notes section attached to it. And in that course notes, it identifies what the modality of the course will be. So that is being loaded right now, even as we speak. So faculty are identifying and they're indicating to their department chairs what modality they are selecting for the spring. And the registrar's office then is working with departments to get that into our system. So that's the answer. That's where you would look to see where what the modality of your course is.
And a follow-up to that one has come in a couple different questions here. Will students still have an option to choose a remote learning option, even if the classes that they are registered for are primarily face-to-face or hybrid?
So in the vast majority of cases, that will be true. So even if a course is delivered hybrid on our campus, where a faculty member is in a classroom with greatly reduced density, so 8 people, 10 people in some courses, and some rooms, it might be 20. All of those rooms have been outfitted with technology that will allow the faculty to simultaneously broadcast the course remotely. I say that there are some exceptions though. So for example, if you have a clinical placement that requires you to be in a physical location, of course, you can't just choose to do that remotely. There may be some internships where that is the case, and a very small number of course experiences where that's the case. So I don't wanna say it's 100% true when it's not, but it's the vast majority of courses, both students and faculty will have that option if they feel unsafe for whatever reason to be able to continue remotely.
Thank you. Have a question in regards to staffing in the spring. If we're a staff member who has been working remotely since March, is it safe to assume we will stay working remotely during the spring semester? And I know we don't want to speculate, but I'll pass that one over to AVP Jones to see if he can answer that one.
Yeah, that's a great question, Sean. I know it's a question that comes up fairly regularly since we communicated the spring plans. With the return of more students to campus, obviously we're going to be providing more services and programs, and that's going to require us to take a look at what staff actually need to come to campus to provide those services and programs. We're going to be working with managers and supervisors over the next month and a half prior to our winter break so that we can have designated what positions and ultimately what people will need to plan to come back to campus, either on a full-time basis in some cases, or periodically or intermittently based upon the service or program that they might support. But I will emphasize that our priority is to try to keep as many people teleworking, working remotely that we possibly can. But we also understand that there will be a need to have more staff on campus to provide support for students for the services and programs that they expect and that they'll need once they come back to campus in January.
Thank you. A question in here I'll pass to Vice President Hurt. Is TU providing opportunities for the flu shot over at the University Health Center in addition to all of the COVID testing that's taking place?
Great, thanks, Sean. Yes, the flu shot, we recognize that, you know, we're encouraging members of the community, and it's just really important as another layer of protection for a campus to offer the flu shot. So the flu shot is available at the health center. If you desire a flu shot, I encourage you to contact the health center to schedule your appointment. They have been providing flu shots over the last several weeks. And so I want to thank those who have already taken advantage of their flu shot, whether through the health center or with your private practitioners. And I want to take an opportunity, as you shared, flu shot and our Sentinel COVID testing, just to thank our health center staff. They have truly been amazing and a really critical resource for our campus, and really has expanded from the Sentinel COVID testing to flu shots to continuing to support the health of our student body. So really want to thank our health center staff for their outstanding service to the campus.
Thank you. And another question somewhat revolving around health and safety and what we're doing over at the health center. This, though, I'll pass to Provost Perot to offer at least an early answer on. I don't know if we even have these plans fully baked yet for after spring break, but is a second COVID baseline test in the plans at this stage for after spring break?
So, I know this answer will... not surprise anybody, but we'll follow what the science says. So we don't know. And so we don't know where we're going to be with the virus in March. I don't want to say exactly what we'll do because we don't know. But what I can absolutely assure people with 100% integrity is that we will follow what the science says. And so we'll make those plans as this as the situation develops, and we will not compromise the safety and health of anybody in the TU community, period. I think that's, so whether it's baseline testing or some other solution, we will follow what the medical advice is at the time. And we'll, so I guess that's my best answer I can give.
That's a good one, thank you. We're about the halfway mark now, so I just want to remind everybody that there are FAQs on the university website that we will be updating with any new waves of information as we deal with the ongoing pandemic, and we will be probably updating it with some from today's town hall. So feel free to share those FAQs with other individuals who aren't able to join today, be it in your departments or divisions, to provide them answers to questions they might have, and please reach out to us in university communications if there are any additional FAQs you think could provide some clarity for the remainder of the university. This one is a little off topic from COVID related, but very timely. Could you share a little bit of detail in regards to early voting on campus? I'll pass this one to President Schatzel.
Thanks, Sean. We are an early voting site, and we also have a ballot box that we've had available for folks to be able to drop their ballots in. Early voting starts Monday. It's no longer in the administration building. Early voting will take place in the South Campus Pavilion adjacent to Auburn House. And we're looking forward to being able to partner in providing that opportunity to everyone. There's been a lot of work that's been done by ECS, by Student Affairs, by Facilities, TUPD, in order to prepare the campus to be able to do that. The expectations is that a lot of people will be making use of early voting. And so we're expecting a lot of folks to be coming to campus as well. We're really, really excited about the fact that our campus community has really responded in terms of their responsibilities to be able to have their voices heard and to vote. As I've told many of the legislators and everyone that I run into, we are one of just 9 universities in the United States where over 85% of our students are registered to vote. And that really tells you about our student body and really tells you what kind of a university we are. The type of work that's been done in order to prepare TU to vote. And I'm going to remind everybody, if you don't have a plan to vote when you get off this call, please develop one and talk to your family members and friends to be able to develop a plan to vote. But the amount of work that's been done by our student affairs group, by athletics, to be able to engage the students has just been remarkable. And that's the result that we have. Dr. Hurt, would you please provide some background in terms of some of what's gone on, particularly with regard to the work of civic engagement and social responsibility in your division?
Sure, thank you. Yes, this is a part of the DNA of Towson University to really be engaged campus community. So really grateful for the leadership coming from civic engagement and social responsibility. You would see a lot of energy in terms of both staff-led engagement, but also really a lot of our students, from our student athletes to many of our student leaders and the students across campus who are leading efforts around engaging and registration. We have a number of opportunities planned from volunteer opportunities leading up to the election and election day, continuing to provide resources to support students and understanding how to exercise their right to vote, and even just continuing to support the various different needs of our students to support them in being civically engaged. So there'll be more information being shared in the coming weeks, in the next week, about opportunities to engage, including for faculty and staff as well. We have a work group that's been working together, representing a number of different areas across campus, again, to really carry out this campus priority and help our entire campus be engaged in this important process.
Luis Sierra has, I know, Vernon, we've talked about this. I just want to recognize Luis Sierra and the team that's worked on that for just the terrific work that they've done working with the students in SGA and athletics as well.
Thank you for those answers. I'll echo the great work by Luis's team. Have a question in about campus construction and an update, and I'll toss this to VP Lowenthal. And specifically, will the new science complex be ready and available for classes in the spring?
Yes, thank you, Sean. The new science complex will be ready. Those of you who've been on campus, if you drive by, it looks like it's ready right now. It's really exciting. And we're actually in the process of loading the building as we speak with furniture. We've got temporary occupancy certificate, and we expect to have permanent occupancy certificate in the next several weeks. And we'll be ready to roll for the spring. And I know the provost is really excited, as well as the dean, to get everybody in the building so that we can have all of our staff, faculty, and students, most importantly, enjoy a beautiful new building.
Have one in here that I'll pass to the provost. Could you give us an update in regards to commencement celebrations, specifically in regards to those students who might be graduating and celebrating in the winter, and then the plans that were underway for the spring celebration?
Sure, thank you. So when we got the state guidance on the limitations of the number of people who could gather, even in an outdoor venue, it made it clear that, it was just pure math, that there was no way for us to successfully pull off the face-to-face commencement that we had planned for and we had really hoped for and that our students wanted and deserved. So the students from the spring and also the students for December. So we've always said we have to follow state and local guidance, but we would have even if it wasn't the law. But so based on that guidance, we couldn't do the face-to-face that we had hoped for. So what we did is then we sent out a questionnaire to all the graduates, to the recent graduates and to the graduates scheduled to graduate in December, and asked, what do you want? Would you prefer that we do a virtual graduation ceremony right now? Or would you prefer to have a delay and wait until hopefully we'll be able to do a face-to-face in the spring? And the overwhelming response by undergraduates and graduate students by far was a preference to delay and wait for a face-to-face in the spring. And so in response to that, that is what we have planned and that's what we've announced. And so ideally we'll be able to have that in the spring. And that's what we're planning for at this time.
Thank you. I have another question in for the provost here as well. Can you tell us a little bit about campus tours and how the university is handling campus tours in the midst of the pandemic?
Sure. So we temporarily stopped the campus tour process, given, again, the guidance and the concern about the spike of COVID that we had. Recently, as things have improved a bit, we've made the decision to go ahead and restart our campus tour program. But it is going to be a little different. So the tours will all be by appointment only. So there's not just a drop-in tour as we used to do. So by appointment, tours will be limited to a single family group at a time. And the tour guides, of course, everybody will be masked. We're a masked campus, and physical distancing will be required to be practiced during each tour. So we expect, so that schedule is just starting again. So we expect those tours to begin in November. But so the admissions staff is doing just a tremendous job getting that started again. And so, you know, we're happy to be able to do that. And in part, I really want to show off that new science building. And so we'll get that started very soon here.
Thank you. A couple questions in that I believe I can pass to VP Lowenthal. Could you give an update in regards to parking for the spring? And in addition, could you give an update in regards to dining for the spring term?
Yes, thank you, Sean. So parking for the spring will be modeled pretty much after what we had in place for the fall, which was at 50%, given the knowledge that many folks who come onto campus are not going to necessarily be coming as frequently. So 50% of both a semesterly rate and a daily rate. And for those students who are actually resident on campus, so they will be here the entire amount of time, but recognizing the financial difficulties, they'll be given a 20% discount as well. As far as dining is concerned, one other item in terms of parking is that the current semesterly passes take you through the end of January. So they expire January 31st. As far as dining is concerned, we will continue to do what we've been doing all along, which is making sure that dining facilities are open to meet the needs of everyone on campus, given that we'll have the 2,300 or so students on campus come spring. Clearly, we will open most of the facilities to be able to meet the needs of everybody on campus.
Thank you. We just had an update in regards to the science complex. We did have a question come in regards to some of the other capital projects going on around the university. Are plans still on track for the new College of Health Professions building? We'll pass that to President Schatzel to give a brief update on.
Absolutely. One of the things that I want to remind everybody is the fact that we are absolutely working hard, as all of you are, for life after COVID, and that it will continue, and that we will be coming back to campus. And the kind of work that's being done is to position us for the next several years of success. The provost is going to be working with the teams in terms of the strategic plan that's going to be rolling out to the deans and rolling out to the campus. And I have to tell you, I am just so pleased with the input from the committees and the direction that the strategic plan is coalescing around in terms of what we're going to do for the next 10 years to be able to continue the momentum and the rise in impact and reputation that we've had as a national university and the impact that we have on the state of Maryland and our region. So I'm thrilled with the progress that's been made and the direction that the strategic plan is starting to point to. Sean, you just asked about capital. Again, that just shows the confidence that the state has in us in the system. And again, that there is life after COVID that provides the fact that we are a vibrant university that has a great degree of impact and importance to our state and influence on our state and the influence on the state's success. As the provost said, the science complex is scheduled to be able to open and to be able to take occupancy there. The union will be 95% open come the fall of 21. Glenn Dining is open right now. The athletic fields are complete, ready to be able to have competition begin there when we can in the springtime. And the College of Health Professions is scheduled to receive the first bit of shovel in the ground money. Around $53 million would be in the budget for next year. I've already, as I said, started talking to the legislatures, the members of the legislatures that would make those kind of decisions that we need to be able to present our case and continue our case for. As I share with many of them, I'm very fortunate to be a president that's advocating for a building of College of Health Professions during a pandemic. But it's also the fact that we know that there's 23,000 unfilled positions in health professions in the state of Maryland, and we are the largest provider of health professionals in the state of Maryland. And forecasts are that shortfall in terms of positions is going to increase because of the toll that the pandemic has taken on healthcare professionals, that they're looking for many folks to retire early, for example, unfortunately. So the case is being made for the College of Health Professions. I'm very cautiously optimistic. I don't say we have it until we have it. But again, the feedback that we're receiving is that we should remain cautiously optimistic. And as everybody knows, the day that we get that money and the day that it's finally approved, I'm going to be running across the campus with a shovel to be able to start digging that big hole to get the College of Health Professions that we very much need to be able to maintain our leadership role. I just want to talk about the Capitol campaign, because again, it's something else that's continuing as well as some of the other buildings. We have the Armory that's continuing, that's going to be opening in the spring. So, and that's, we're going to open that in the springtime in the old Armory up in Uptown Towson. The entrepreneurial efforts as a cluster and as a center for entrepreneurship on the campus is going to have that. We're going to put new venture operations in there. We're partnering with Baltimore County in terms of putting small business support in there. And we're really thrilled with the work that's gone in there to be able to support the realization of that dream, to be able to have an entrepreneurship center that we can really connect with the business community in the county and in the region, and have our students and our faculty be able to connect that way. And it's coming to fruition in the spring. 401 Washington is continuing, and we're going to be looking to have people move in there as well. So there's much that's going on that that we're very, very excited about. And the Capitol campaign, we're about $60 million or more than halfway through with our target of $100 million for the Capitol campaign. And we've received about four very, very large seven-figure gifts in support of the Capitol campaign that are historic in nature, that we're going to be continuing to announce. So it just shows you the support for the university, particularly during a pandemic, to have that philanthropy continue. So it shows you that the degree of confidence that people have with the university and with everything we're doing is very, very strong. But I want to make sure that I take the time to remind everybody that the struggles of our students and the struggles of our faculty and staff continue with regard to the effect of the pandemic. So don't forget, if you are all capable of doing so, please support our emergency funds to support our students and support our faculty and staff, because those needs have not gone away and they will continue. And every dollar counts to be able to support those that are struggling. So again, I thank everybody that supported those funds, and please continue to do so.
I just add very quickly a shout out to our facility staff, as well as our third-party vendors, Whiting Turner in the Science Complex and Barton Mallow at the Union, and many others, and our partners at UMB, who really have made all this construction stay on schedule to the degree we can, despite the pressures of COVID. It's understandable that folks have been out at times, and the response has really been incredible. So I just want to mention that.
Thank you both. We're about 15 minutes from the close here. Just a reminder that we will have a recorded version of this available on the website. And we have had a couple questions come in here recently from folks who have joined the call a little bit late. And I believe some of those have been answered earlier on. There is a new one in, however, and we did announce earlier this week a change in some plans in regards to the football season. But a follow-up question here is in regards to that decision and what led to that decision. As well as for the student athletes on other teams in the spring season, will those teams continue with their season? So I'm going to pass this to Vice President Hurt to help answer the student athlete question there.
Great. Thanks, Sean. So in terms of our spring plan, our spring sports will go as planned. That's the decision. That's the planning that we have now. The teams are continuing to prepare, train, practice, and preparation for that. We did announce the shift in the football competition plan. So I'll just kind of, you know, give a little history. So the decision was made to postpone the fall sports and move that to the spring, including football. And recently, CAA shared the plan competition schedule. If you take a look at it, it was a pretty truncated schedule for the spring. And Athletic Director Tim Leonard and his team really engaged and consulted with the health professionals, with the coaches, and I think most importantly with our student athletes in the football program. If you think about this, the impact of football as a sport, having a very truncated spring competition season, and then preparing to turn right around to prepare for a normal fall season, that would have, you know, created some real challenges, the potential of long-term physical challenges and injuries for our student athletes. We're seeing that in other college programs. We're seeing that in the NFL. And so the decision was made that the program will continue to practice, continue with training, continue to focus on preparation for the full fall season. Again, we continue to center health and safety as the priority. And so this was a health and safety decision that was really informed by our student athletes. And so I appreciate the leadership of our student athletes and really sharing their voice and being part of that discussion and decision-making. It's important to note that their year of eligibility will continue to be protected via the NCAA. And so we'll continue to move forward.
All right, thank you for that. We have in a question, I'll pass this back to you as well, Dr. Hurt. It's in regards to if a vaccine is available soon for COVID-19, will we be able to get that out to the campus in the spring?
So it's pretty premature. We don't know kind of where things are is happening in terms of the vaccine. Certainly once a vaccine is available, then we'll continue to kind of follow the guidance from the state health department as well as the local health department. But I think it's still early, still premature. And so as we make decisions around that, we'll certainly communicate that to campus.
Sean, if I could just add, I think everybody has seen Governor Hogan release the vaccine distribution plan. And that would be something that we would follow. And if you take a look at the plan as appropriate, the first that would receive it would be first responders in the state because they're most at risk. And then they've got different populations that would be would receive it next. And it would be, for example, seniors that are in community centers in terms of living in assisted living or convalescent homes. Then it goes to the incarcerated in terms of prisons because of the issues with regard to social distancing and risks to them. So we'll follow the plan for that. We are a distribution site as a campus, so we'll coordinate with the state with regard to that, and we'll keep everybody informed, just as Dr. Hertz said, when that becomes available. But as I said, if you check what the governor has and what Maryland Public Health has, that will let you know in terms of where we sit and where it would be distributed at an individual basis.
Thank you. Question then for the provost. Will faculty be given access to teach from classrooms during the mini-mester and during the first 2 weeks of remote learning during the spring term?
So we will continue to have that opportunity for faculty. So again, following all the safety protocols, faculty members have the ability to come in at this time to teach from the classroom if they'd like to take advantage of that technology and deliver remotely. So that continues to exist. What I would say to the faculty member though, of course, is you do need to notify your department chair that you intend to be on campus. And then you need to, as part of that, if you've said to this point, I'm not going to come to campus, and so therefore I don't participate in the quick scan procedure. If you are going to start coming to campus, then you do need to participate in that layer of safety, identify that, get signed up for the quick scan, and do that on a daily basis. But yes, you'll be able to use that technology should you choose to.
Thank you. I'll pass this question to Vice President Hurt. If the situation surrounding the pandemic does improve in the spring, is there a possibility that policy changes could take place in regards to guests and events on campus? I think there's others that might be able to answer that question too, but we'll start with VP Hurt.
Sure. So that's certainly one of the things, as the provost mentioned earlier, we're going to continue to be guided by the guidance by the state, by the local health department, and we'll continue to keep our eye on policies and make those adjustments as needed. And so that'll certainly be, one of those policies that we'll take a look at and continue to make sure it's in alignment with our state campus and the local guidance.
And another follow-up question from some earlier discussion in regards to quarantine space and isolation space on campus. We noted that it was doubled. Somebody has asked, what will the new capacity be in the spring? Go to Vice President Hurt for that one as well.
Sure. So we'll have approximately just under 200 beds available for isolation and quarantine. We're also prepared for some additional surge space for isolation only. We've been able to work with the Medical Advisory Committee around plans and options there. And so they've been able to give us the green light on both the initial dedicated space as well as surge space. So we feel very confident that we'll be well over kind of the guidance percentage. Many campuses have prepared for about 10% of their campus residency for isolation and quarantine space. We will, with our surge space, will be well over that. So we're feeling really confident.
Thank you. Have a question in about travel for the spring and work travel. If that is something that the university is going to enable to take place again. I believe that could be a question possibly for either VP Lowenthal or AVP Jones.
Yeah, I can take that question. The travel freeze is going to remain in place for the spring. Again, we can't speculate. I know people have questions as to whether things improve, but if they do at any time that there is any change, we would communicate that back out to the community. But for now, the travel freeze remains in place through the spring.
All right, and I have one final question and we'll hand it over to President Schatzel here at the end for some closing thoughts. But are there any efforts being made to monitor and assess the non-compliance with masking and social distancing guidelines on campus? Do we know if our messaging is working or if we need to modify those things for the spring term? By and large, I believe we do have pretty great compliance on our campus, but I'll pass this one over to I guess Provost Perot to take a crack at this one. Also AVP Jones could weigh in as well on the compliance piece.
Sure, so I'll start and then I'll kick it over to Steve Jones here. So for those of us who have been on campus, I think that you'll see by and large, there's very high compliance with the requirements of the mask and the physical distancing. It's a very, very low density on campus if you've been here. So you can see that here and there. And I'll say that in my personal experiences, if you have to remind somebody, put a mask up, there hasn't been a problem. People are doing it. That we're not seeing some of the things you see on videos from around the country that the compliance is very, very high. We also have very high compliance with our quick scan. And this actually far exceeded expectations and far exceeds what the medical advisor said was a significant number, that you had to hit a certain percentage for it to have a significant impact. We're well into the mid 80s in compliance on the quick scan every single day, and 85th percentile, and that's just outstanding. And so from the measures that we can see, complying with the testing, complying with sentinel testing, complying with the quick scan, all of the things where we actually are able to do a data measurement, our compliance is extraordinary. Our community is taking this seriously and really does understand that this is about keeping each other safe, not just yourself, but it's about others. And that's what TU is all about. And so we're seeing that represented very intensely in our results. But I don't know, AVP Jones, do you have anything you'd like to add to that?
Well, you captured it very well. We have a high level of compliance, and that's a testament to our community. Our community is committed to making sure that we recognize there's a safety and health issue on campus and away from campus, and we take it serious. And while we know there is going to be situations for non-compliance, I think we have corrective action policies in place, as we've communicated previously, we'll take a look at each situation on its merits to determine what's the most appropriate action to take. And fortunately, we haven't had to really get into too many, but at the same time, we also think we each have to take responsibility for ourselves. And if in fact we see non-compliance, we should speak up if we're comfortable. If we're not comfortable, we need to let someone know, let your manager know, your supervisor know. And we're currently in conversation with our shared governance groups about how we might have some mechanism for people to report noncompliance, so we can address that also. But we do take it serious. We are very, very confident that we'll continue to have high levels of compliance, because we know the TU community wants to protect the TU community, and we're thankful for that.
If then Dr. I could just chime in.
Yeah,
just chime in briefly. You know, as we did in the beginning of the fall semester, messaging is really important. So many of our student leaders and student ambassadors and influential students were part of a campaign to really encourage students to be in compliance. And even though we're much lower density, it's important to note, we still have a few hundred students who are in residence on campus. And so we have a solid number of students, and I'm really proud of the compliance that we've seen, you know, in our residential spaces around campus. And so we expect that to continue. But it's really important to note that one of the changes we made this year was an addendum to our student code as it relates to COVID-related policies. And so we have codified that within policy and prepared through our student conduct to ensure that compliance. You know, as you would report any other matter, conduct matter, the same venues report applies. And so you know, it's important that the campus recognizes that both from an education standpoint, but also from a policy standpoint, we're gonna continue to hold our campus accountable, because it's gonna be critical for our success going forward.
Thank you. We had a great comment come in here that makes a great segue for us on the compliance piece. I believe this comes in from one of our staff members in human resources. We had almost 95% of employees complete the return to TU training. Amazing is what this comment says. So a lot of great questions came in today. We're gonna to close off the questions here. Final one, I'll pass over to President Schatzel. Mental health has been a challenge for many of university faculty, staff, and our students. Could you speak a little bit about what the university is doing to support the mental health of the entire campus community?
So thank you, Sean. So one of the things that I want to make sure that we talk about is the fact that this virus has impacted people physically, but has also impacted them emotionally and mentally. I sit on the board of several hospitals, and I was actually talking to the CEO of Shepherd Pratt, and estimates are the fact that, you know, of course we have over 200,000 people that have died from COVID, but projections are that will be double, triple, quadruple the number of people that will actually possibly die from the impact of either suicide or substance abuse related to the COVID outbreak. So the mental health that people are experiencing, the challenges to mental health are widespread, and they are real. You know, one of the things that we're trying to do as a community from the very beginning is to be able to support our campus community and the challenges that they face, both professionally as well as personally. And this is a time to be compassionate, and this is a time to be understanding of the colleagues that we're working with because of those challenges that they're dealing with, or that members of their family or friends are dealing with as well. What I want to be able to do is to make sure that we talk about what we have available on the campus in terms of resources. And I want to send it over to Dr. Hurt to talk about the counseling center and referrals that people can be able to give to the counseling center for those challenges. And then Steve Jones, if you would talk about what's available to faculty and staff. And I just want to encourage everybody to understand what's available to them, to be able to support them, and to understand the fact that we have an understanding of the challenges that are in place, and we want to support our community as they're facing those challenges. And Dr. Hurt, if you would begin.
Sure. I mean, we're certainly seeing the impact. You know, we have the kind of dual pandemics between COVID-19 and issues of racial justice. within the country. We're in election season, and so the anxiety around the political landscape is real. And so we kind of have this almost perfect storm happening now that's having an impact. And so we want to respond to that. Counseling Center has done a phenomenal job in both pivoting to supporting students through telemental help and also expanding. We've expanded the numbers of appointments that are available. We have now for the first time made available daily the daily appointments, so you can get a appointment at the counseling center same day, which is a significant transition and enhancement for supporting mental health for our students. The last thing I'll share is that we now have 24-hour support. So after five, we have Protocol, which is a mental health, mental health service that's available to our students to have services, have a support after five, on the weekends, holidays. So, we're able to provide 365, 7 days a week mental health support for our campus community. So really want to thank Dr. Molly Herman, who's our interim director of the Counseling Center, and that entire team for their great work in really expanding and meeting the needs of the moment.
Thank you.
Steve, do you just want to add some in terms of faculty and staff?
And much like the resources for students, we have some very robust and comprehensive resources for faculty and staff. One of our benefits, our employee assistance program, which is referred guidance resources, is the group that we're using. And you can access it via the website with benefits. 24/7 counselors available. It's easy to access. It's confidential. It provides some free initial services. I believe it's up to five or six counseling sessions up front, and it's for you as well as the people that live with you, for your dependents too. So I would encourage you, if you have a need or you have an interest, to look up the services. It's readily available, and we certainly want to promote the use of it for all of our faculty and staff.
Thank you. I want to thank the entire panel as well as all who submitted questions today for their participation in today's town hall. We've taken note of a number of the questions we did not get to that warrant additional feedback, and we'll be incorporating those into upcoming university communications as well as the FAQs that I mentioned that are on the website. Also, as mentioned earlier, there will be a recording of this town hall posted on towson.edu later this week. And before we close out today, I want to hand it back over to President Schatzel one more time for some closing thoughts.
Thank you, Sean. Again, I just want to thank everybody for all the support that they've given both to each other as well as to our students during this unprecedented time that we first started experiencing in March of this year. I don't think anybody anticipated that we'd be where we are right now. I think some people thought it would end more quickly than we've seen it happen. But as a community, we've worked very, very hard to be able to support each other and to continue to provide the outstanding academic experience to our students, as well as to continue the scholarly and creative activity that we have within our faculty. And the support of the staff has been remarkable and so important to that effort. We'll make sure that we keep everybody informed if there's any major decisions or news that we receive or information as time passes. But hopefully this has been informative for everybody, particularly as the fact that we're looking at the spring semester. My expectation is that we will have another town hall probably at the beginning of December after Thanksgiving break, to be able to provide everybody with an update as we move to the holiday period at the end of December. But again, I just want to close off with thanking everybody for everything that you're doing to support the members of our community, as well as our fantastic students. And I just want to be able to say, please stay positive, please stay safe. And again, thank you for everything that you're doing for Towson University.